topic this morning is Sola Christus, and we'll be talking about only Jesus and what that looks like and what that means both historically and today in modern application. So we're going to start with prayer. Glenn, you're going to share a little bit of a testimony, and then we'll go through our material, and if we have any time at the end, notice I said if we have any time at the end, we'll take some questions. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we're looking forward to what you have in store for us today as we continue our celebration, our textual celebration of the 500-year anniversary of the protest at Wittenberg. Help us, Father, to bask in the light that shines upon us from our Protestant forefathers and foremothers. Help us to have an awareness that we are not only Seventh-day Adventists, and we are not only Christians or theists or monotheists, but a big part of our identity is that we are Protestants. And Father, I know that for some this might be a little technical and maybe a little historical. I know that others are just eating it up. But help us to appreciate that we got here somehow. We ended up here somehow. And to have an understanding of historically how we got here. Father, there's that saying, those that don't know history are doomed to repeat it. We want to have at least enough familiarity with our history and our heritage as Protestants that we know where we've come from, where we are, and perhaps most importantly, where we're going. So be with us now as we turn our attention to Scripture and to history and to Jesus today in particular. And in his name we pray, let everyone say, Amen. Amen.
What began in 1517 as an invitation by Martin Luther for a theological discussion among the intelligentsia ended up being the seeds of a global revolution. History has never been the same since that act in 1517. Luther thought that the gospel of the scriptures, which taught that man was saved by faith alone, through grace alone, in Christ alone, for the glory of God alone, would be welcomed by the church that he loved. He had no sense at all that his declaration of rebellion against the sale of indulgences would start such a cascade and continuum of events. 25 years after the 1517 nailing of the thesis to the door at Wittenberg, the Council of Trent declared in no uncertain terms that Martin Luther and his followers were persona non grata within the fellowship of the Catholic Church. As we look at some of the sticking points, we have recognized that Luther and his followers believed that the scriptures alone must be our source of authority, that salvation was through grace alone, through the kindness of God alone, that it was through faith alone and in Christ alone. And the Catholic Church, to a certain extent, would adopt some of Martin Luther's teachings, but not be prepared to go all the way. They wanted to protect the right of the church to be the continuum of the custodianship of the keys of the kingdom in which they were authorized by Christ to dispense to the penitent salvation, forgiveness, and the absolution of sins. When we look at the Great Reformation and we try and see if we can distill it to its essence, I like the words of Martin himself, who said, true faith lays hold of Christ and leans on him, what?
Alone.
Alone. Our opponents cannot understand this. In their blindness, they cast away the precious pearl Christ and hang on to their stubborn works. They have no idea what faith is. How can they teach it to others? For Martin Luther, he looked at Catholicism as a systematic theology and recognized that it was flawed to its essence because it attempted to defend and retain the idea that merit could be obtained in reducing temporal debt. Merit could be obtained in leveraging heaven. Merit could be obtained by the activity of the church and those who subscribed to its dictates. In Martin Luther's mind, he simply arrived at a theological position that said our opponents cannot understand the idea that salvation is independent of the priests and of the saints and of the sacraments. It is through Christ alone. Catholic teaching at that time unashamedly taught that salvation could not occur outside of its borders. Even today, since Vatican II, they still look at Protestant churches as lost daughters that need to come back into the fold to benefit from what they have to offer. The indulgences that caused Luther to rise up in protest against the system of Catholic belief was a protest against any idea that merit could be obtained by activity. And by way of introduction this morning, I thought that perhaps, as we've been saying this week, that truth really is not practical until it's personal. Truth really, I guess, is refined and distilled in the experience of human activity. And I thought that maybe for a couple of minutes I could perhaps just share a little of my own story, and it may highlight why the five solas of the Reformation are so precious to me and why I think that Adventism is so grounded in its infancy in the seminal ideas that have flourished into a more robust system of thought but is still growing in the Adventist Church. When I was about 17, I left high school. I was dearly loved by my high school principal. He bestowed on me an award in my final year for being the citizen of year 12. It was almost like a title of righteousness that I claimed. I was the good boy. I was the boy who stayed online when all the others were drinking and smoking and experimenting with this and with that. I was the dependable one. I was the one who was preaching in churches and going to Pathfinder camps and helping in chapels and worship services. And David Fall, some of you may remember him, he said, "Yeah, Glenn, worthy of the brand citizen." So here I am in my first year of university and beginning to recognize that the horizon that defined the space that I lived in was slightly broader. And I began to explore new relationships and new friends, and I can remember David Fall coming up to me, and if there are any high school principals here this morning, this is a great tip for you all. And he came up to me and he said, "Glenn, if you don't get your act together, you're going to hell." He didn't quite use those words, but essentially, he loved me enough to confront me. And he said, "Glenn, I don't like the trajectory that your life is going. You need to turn around."
Mm.
And I went home and I cried myself to sleep. And I thought, isn't it great that there is somebody who loved me enough that he would take the risk of ruining our friendship by calling me to account? And I went home and I cried and I recognized that I had started since I'd left the college, Sydney Adventist College, that I love so much, and had started to expand my wings and to fly in the secular world of Sydney University, that perhaps he was right. Perhaps I needed to refocus and get centered again. And so I started to attend a Bible study group in Sydney with 70 other young people. Every Friday and Saturday night, we would be down at King's Cross handing out Steps to Christ and street preaching and witnessing. And I found a new love in a group of people that made Christ the center, the focus, and the be-all and end-all of their life. Within a few short years, I was preaching at Vision Valley. Does anyone ever remember Vision Valley? I was preaching at Vision Valley, got scolded for preaching on a Sunday morning without a tie. Poor people wouldn't listen to me because I wasn't wearing a tie, and I found that was rather a challenge to me. Driving home from Vision Valley, my car overheated, and I was parked by the side of the road, and a text was brought to my attention while I was sitting there in the car beside the road from I believe, a divine moment in my life, one of the few moments when I really believe God spoke to me. And the text from the Old Testament, "Before honor is humility," was just flashed into my head. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to be on a life journey. God is going to take me through a process to open my eyes to what the Scriptures really, really mean.
Mm.
And I can remember as my university journey progressed, that I had an older sister who lived in Wurunga, and I was in a nurse's residence in Parramatta. And for those of you who know the geography of Sydney, that's pretty well an uphill ride. I wasn't rich enough to afford petrol, so I would ride on my bike up the hill every Sunday morning from Parramatta, which is close to sea level, all the way up to where the Sydney Adventist Hospital is, which is one of the highest points in Sydney. And I would go and visit my sister. And at that time, my sister was also spreading her wings, and she was also seeing what the world had to offer, and she was experiencing the music scene of Sydney, and she was visiting nightclubs, and she was starting to play around with a few things that I wouldn't eat and drink. And I can remember going to wanting to witness to her, and somehow I was unable to really say anything, because I had this confused idea that The holiness which I was wanting to pursue was in this part of my life, but happiness, the music and the culture and all of the fun things were in this part of my life. And there was a disconnect between what I would call the parameters of happiness, which my sister was enjoying, and the parameters of holiness, which I was enjoying. And when I really think about my own life as a Christian, my own life as a Christian has become vitalized by one simple concept that I want to share with you today. And it is this radical idea that Jesus, when he comes into your heart, will help you to understand for the first time that the devil is a liar and the father of it, and that the happiness and holiness parameters are the same fence.
Amen.
Happiness is not found in the world and holiness in the church. Happiness is not all of the things that we want to do but know we can't, and holiness is all the things we don't want to do but know we have to. The moment we recognize that the devil's invitation to eat of this fruit because it's desired to make you wise and it's beautiful to look at, and the sensory and the physical and the emotional experience that are attached to disobeying God will bring you happiness, is always found to leave you naked, ashamed, and vulnerable.
Mm.
And as God has worked with me over the last 20 or 30 years, I have to say there are still times when I climb over the fence and I want to run out and see whether happiness is still outside the parameters of holiness. But if Adventists and if people who are wrestling with the dichotomous apparent extremes of Reformation thought would recognize that happiness and holiness are actually coincident, then I think a lot of the questions that we bring up when we're trying to wrestle with the theology of the Reformation would be resolved. It is not that faith is here and works are there. It is not that obedience is here and belief is here. When we recognize that God invites us into a partnership, into a relationship in which he wants us to obey, not because we have to, but because our hearts are changed and our whole perspective is reoriented, then all of a sudden we don't see merit in obedience. We see it as the greatest gift that God could have. I was talking to a really good friend of mine on the way home yesterday, and I'll wrap my testimony up with this because I think it's really powerful. And we were talking how David in the connection tent has asked people to give their testimonies. Anyone heard the testimonies in the connection tent? Aren't they beautiful? Aren't they precious? And David deliberately and strategically has invited people who are still wet. Most of them have been Christians. In fact, all of them have been Christians, Seventh-day Adventist Christians, for less than a year. Is that correct, David? And it's really exciting. And I was talking to somebody who's a generational Adventist like I am and said, wouldn't it be interesting if we asked David next year, and I'm not suggesting this, David, but we were just for the point of argument, wouldn't it be interesting if next year we got testimonies from those that were generational Adventists, that every one of them was a generational Adventist? And she said to me, yeah, what would we say? what do we say? Our lives are so undramatic. And I said, how can you say that? Look at you. You've been married to the same man your whole life. None of your children are in rehab. You don't have a psychiatrist on speed dial. You haven't got a criminal record. You know, like the lives that Jesus has given us, we sometimes think that they're unspectacular.
Yeah, that's right.
But I would like to say that there is such a great privilege in understanding the Christian basis for our life. We have been given an abundant life. And all my life I've wrestled with this faith works argument, this faith works tension. And my journey is not over. David gently points me back into the middle, and I hope that I can make contributions to his understanding as well. It's a difficult thing to explain, but it's not a difficult thing to watch. In the life of Jesus Christ, we see a seamless merging of a love for righteousness and a hatred for iniquity. And when God can reorient our minds so that we stop pining for the fruits of the devil and we recognize that God has delivered us to an abundant life in which holiness and happiness are the same thing, then I think that we will really find that our Christian life will be fantastic and an experience that we want to live.
Amen. Beautiful.
The Catholics themselves were not ashamed of the idea that we are not saved by works. And notice this from the Council of Trent. It's a very, very interesting statement. If anyone says that a man may be justified before God by his own works, whether done through the teaching of human nature or that of the law, without the grace of God through Jesus Christ, let him be anathema. Are you surprised that the Catholics teach that? Let me unpack that for you just so that we can try and make it a little bit more friendly for a millennial generation. The Catholic Church is saying is that if anybody says that we can be justified before God by our own works without the input of Jesus, let them be an anathema. Can the Adventists say amen?
We can say amen.
When we actually begin to unpack some of the arguments that were going on between the Reformers and the Catholic Church, it's not always easy to take sides. Would you agree, David?
That's true.
There are many, many cases where Luther and Calvin say things that are so extreme that I retreat and go, man alive, I'm going to be cheering for the Catholics on this one. And there are other times when the Catholics say things that are so extreme, you go, I can't bear it. And it's very, very common for us in arguments that we fall into deep, deep trouble where we try and make the dichotomy between black and white so evident. There's often grayness in these arguments. And the Catholics taught very clearly that we are not saved by works. The works that we do are tied to the grace of Jesus Christ. But notice, they don't leave it there. They go on in the Council of Trent to say this: if anyone saith that the good works of one that is justified through grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, but if anybody says that the good works of one that is justified, which he performs through the grace of God and the merit of Jesus Christ, whose living member he is, does not merit,
truly merit,
increase of grace, eternal life, and the attainment of that eternal life, let him be anathema. So what the Catholics are essentially saying is that to come to Christ, we are happy to accept that that is by Christ alone. But once you are in Christ, once you have a relationship with Christ, and the church offers you penance, indulgence, and other forms of works to involve yourself in, participating in the Mass and the sacraments, then you are adding to the merit that you have with heaven. And it is this idea that Luther and his colleagues found so offensive. And as I think of the Seventh-day Adventist perspective, I wonder if we are at risk of somehow subtly giving the same kind of message.
Hmm.
People come to Christ just as they are, and we baptize them, but immediately we hold them to account. If you're not giving up smoking, if you haven't beaten your pornography addiction, if you haven't finished with your drinking, if you haven't stopped watching R-rated movies in public places where people can see you doing it, all of these things that we define, we somehow give people the expectation that they have to live up to a measurement and a bar. And I have observed in my 30 years of being a committed Seventh-day Adventist that we are not changing our theology, we're just lowering the bar. We haven't really addressed the underlying tension between the obligation to be good once you are saved. What we have done is it all right to have a cup of coffee? Oh, sure, if you're an interstate truck driver and you have to drive 16 hours from Brisbane to Perth, it's much better to have a cup of coffee than it is to run over a pedestrian, and so coffee's in. Is it okay to have a little bit of alcohol? Oh, yes, well, we can lower the bar fairly effectively by saying that evidence points out that there's certain meritorious value in the red pigments of red wine, and it's been shown through many studies to thin our blood and avoid stroke. So a little wine for your stomach's sake, that's brilliant. Let's just lower the bar. And all the way through my Adventist life, what's wrong with swimming on Sabbath? We go bush walking? Okay, let's just lower the bar. And all of the arguments are about what's wrong, what's wrong, what's wrong, and we're not actually addressing the underlying theology of how does good works contribute to the salvation experiment. We just continue to lower the bar, 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 until the bar is so low that everybody can be saved. We can feel comfortable about our salvation. But this is not the argument that was happening at the level of the Reformation, nor should it be the argument that lies within Adventism today. If we lower the bar far enough, everybody feels comfortable, everybody feels entitled to salvation, and they can still live as unrepentant, unregenerate, Christ-separated, independent Christians who are only heading for the wrong place. We cannot be justified before God through our good works or our bad works. There is only one way to be justified, and that is through absolute, total dependence on the saving merits of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that we are not adequate in ourselves to consider anything as coming from ourselves. Where is our adequacy from? Our adequacy must be from God. But having said that, Once we are immersed in God and the love of Christ constrains us and the Spirit intercedes for us and the Lord works in us both to will and to do of his good salvation, will we be passive and inactive? I like to think of, it's a dangerous metaphor, but I like to think of the abusive relationship between a patriarchal husband and his poor wife. And the patriarchal husband somehow feels a sense of entitlement that once he's married, once he's got the certificate of marriage, he can just sit back in his lounge chair, get a neck rub, a foot rub, freshly squeezed orange juice, his paper laid out nicely before him, his evening meal cooked, his shirts ironed. Sounds like my place. The certificate of marriage does not entitle us to do nothing. The love that we have together as a couple ought to motivate us to be active and engaged and connected and sharing a common goal and building a common kingdom and working together for the betterment of our home as well as to reach out to bless others. And this idea of Christianity that we need to be frightened of obedience, we need to be frightened of good works, we need to be frightened of transformed, radically Christian lives is to me just, it just betrays to me that many of us are still thinking with this idea that we are attempting to earn salvation, and because we don't want to do anything that would convince anyone that we're attempting to earn salvation, the best thing we can do is either be dead or asleep. I would like to see our church radically transformed by recognizing that happiness and holiness are bound by the same parameters. We do not claim merit from our activity. God says, I want to bring you back into a functional relationship with me so that together we can accomplish a truly effective demonstration of what the gospel looks like. Martin Luther had this to say. Let me see. I think I skipped it.
There you go.
I must listen to the gospel. It tells me not what I must do, but what Jesus Christ, the Son of God, has done for me. You know, it's really, really interesting. At the same time that Martin Luther was revolutionizing theological thought, Copernicus and Kepler and Galileo were on a journey to revolutionize the way we understood the universe. And I just find that it's an outstanding parallelism of how the two arguments were really the one. Instead of things circling around the earth, instead of them being geocentric, those in astronomy said, there's a better model. It's heliocentricity. We need to recognize that the earth is not the center of the universe. It is the sun. And in theological thought, it's the same thing. We need to move away from theology, which is really reduced to its essence, centered around us. And we need to instead center our theology around God. What has Jesus done for us?
Amen.
What has he done for us? Equality with God was not something to be grasped, but laying it aside, he came down to this earth and took upon himself the form of a servant. And he humbled himself and was made obedient to death. When we try and encapsulate in Ellen White's mind, when we spend that thoughtful time each day contemplating the life of Christ, we must be amazed that God, who had nothing really to gain by leaving heaven, to come down to this earth and to be rejected and treated shamefully and nailed to a cross, except that his love drove him to rescue us. It ought to reorient and make us ashamed of ever looking to ourselves as contributors towards the gospel. The Catholic Church had a system that revolved around the sacraments, the penance, the indulgences. A Catholic had to participate in church activity to maintain a living and active and connection with God. When Martin Luther and his followers challenged the claims of the church to be the dispensary of righteousness, holiness, and salvation, it was a revolution which made a deadly wound on the church and altered the course of Christian history forever. Martin Luther had this to say about the Catholic Church: the one who does much work is not the righteous one, but the one who without work has much faith in Christ. Jesus and the cross were so attractive to Luther that as early as 1518, he made this statement in the Heidelberg Disputations. While I was researching for this, I came across a Lutheran blogger and pastor. He wouldn't give me his name, so I can't quote him, but he said this so beautifully that David agrees that we ought to just bring this to you.
You just have to go back one.
I have to go back one? I skipped.
On your clicker.
Yeah.
Oh, maybe I'm incorrect.
No, I think that's okay.
Okay.
I think that's okay. This Lutheran pastor, in trying to distill the essence of the argument between Catholics and Lutherans, took away the labels and the tribalism that comes from they're right and we're wrong, and instead speaks of two theologians, the theologian of glory and the theologian of the cross. And listen to what he says. The theologian of glory would push me to advance my religious life, become more moral and ethical, seek out glorious, mystical, spiritual experiences, and every day and in every way become better and better. So a theologian of glory sees something, all these religious moral activities, and calls it what it is not, salvific and sanctifying. Do you think that a Christian life should become more moral and ethical?
Hmm.
Do you think that a Christian life should long for glorious, mystical, spiritual experiences and every day and in every way become better and better?
Of course.
Absolutely. There is no doubt that this is the reality of the life of a Christian. But should we label it and call it that which it is not? Should we see merit? Should we see it as being a contributor to our salvation experience? Should we see sanctification as something that is necessary in order to gain leverage with heaven? Not at all. That is the theologian of glory. What does a theologian of the cross look at? The theologian of the cross regards as holy any moment when I'm captivated by my Lord's cross, over against my captivation to my own self, my victory, my visible righteousness and glory. If Christ alone is the way, the truth and the life, then it is his suffering and death that are my glory.
Amen.
And whenever and wherever I am shaped to his same cross by the circumstances of life that work to kill my self-sustenance and reliance, I am already glorified.
Mm, thank you.
When am I the most saved? I am the most saved when I'm the most in Christ. Can you say amen? I am in Christ the moment that I yield to him in surrender when he bids me come. And I am in Christ the moment when in glorification I fall at his feet and lay my crown and say, you alone are worthy.
Yes.
In no part of the Christian journey will there ever come a time where independence and self-righteousness will play a role in the salvation story.
Amen.
Does that mean that we sit back in our armchairs and wait watching Netflix till Jesus comes, glad that the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, covers all sins?
Certainly not.
When we fall in love with Jesus and we recognize that happiness and holiness are bound by the same parameters, then we will find obedience a joy. You know, Romans is a magnificent dissertation on righteousness by faith. And I know when I was at university, I was always more interested in doing fun stuff like King's Cross than I was in studying. And there would come that critical moment in time where the exams were just around the corner and you had 24 hours to cram. And in that context, you would never read the textbook. You would read the cover sheet, the introduction, and the conclusion. You would try and get the synopsis. You would go to the textual references, and you would look for the abstracts. Do you know what I'm talking about? And if you look at the book of Romans, there is a beautiful introduction, verse 1 to 5 of chapter 1, and then there is a beautiful conclusion, chapter 16, towards the end of the verse. And both of them talk about the fact that the whole purpose of Paul's argument is that the Gentiles could experience the obedience of faith. In contradistinction to the obedience of works, Romans is not an argument about righteous living. It's an argument about methodology. Is that a fair comment, David?
I'm processing it.
He's processing it. Paul, in his introduction, says that the mystery of the gospel has been revealed to me and through the evidence of the scriptures and the prophets has come so that the Gentiles can experience the obedience of faith.
Mm.
And in his summary, he sums it up the same way. And in the 16 chapters that lie in the middle, his main point of contention is this argument between the righteousness which is sought apart from Christ, being ignorant of Christ's righteousness, they're out to establish their own righteousness, and they have never surrendered themselves to the righteousness of God. The law cannot do anything. It is weak through the flesh. It is impossible for those independent of Christ to experience the joy of holiness. But those who are in Christ are uncondemned, because what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the God might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh but according to the Spirit. The argument of Romans is that holiness and happiness and obedience cannot be found in independence. It can only be found in dependence. It can only be found in a belief system that loves and looks for Christ. The law says, do this, and it is never done. Grace says, believe in this one, and forthwith everything is done. Seventh-day Adventist Christians, we need to be at Jesus' feet. Can you say amen? We need to understand that in him there is a robe of righteousness in which there is not one thread of human devising, and it is in him that we will be saved. I can remember the aha moment for myself when I was reading a General Conference Bulletin of 1893 in my attempts to make sense of what people were talking about, the 1888 message, and I read this passage where Ellen White describes the joy that came across a group of people who had preached the law till they were dry as the hills of Gilboa, and what joy came to them when they found out that Christ had done something for them that they didn't need to do again for themselves. Christ had provided the payment of sin, and he had lived a holy life, and he had said to them, die to your own journey and immerse yourself in my journey, bear my yoke, and I will do the heavy lifting, and I will take you from where I found you all the way to where you need to be. The life of a Christian will not be separated from holiness, for in holiness there is happiness, and in happiness and the abundant life there is Jesus. We need to be zealous for good works, not because we want to earn the right to the kingdom, but because we want to become advertisements for a great God who will do for others what he is doing for us.
Beautiful.
But we need so much in our own understanding of theology to forever dispense with the idea that there is merit to be obtained. I'm just going to take a brief moment before David jumps in. Or David, do you want to jump in now?
No, it's great. I'm loving it.
All right. I just want to take a brief moment to try and perhaps clear up for you the way that it's become clear in my head. When you understand these opposite points of view, what I would like to call the theological dichotomy that was created by Augustinian theology and an attempt by Luther and the Reformers to reconcile the tension between what God does and what we do. Can I ask you to consider a spectrum at which at one end of the spectrum we have the idea that God does really everything and man is really passive, because ultimately at the end of the day the depraved nature of man is so significant that man can never be expected to play a role, a part in either believing, accepting, or saying yes to God. We would describe that as hard Calvinism, as absolute determinism, that God really runs a divine lotto based on his own desires and just elects one to be saved and one to be lost. We'll put that right down at one end and we'll call that hard Calvinism. At the other end, we would see that the whole salvation experience is where God sits back on his majestic throne and surveys his creation and says, which one of them have earned the right to my favor? How many of them have been good enough? And if we were to put in the scales of the universe, their good deeds and their bad deeds, how many of them have done enough to measure up, to make the grade? And for me to say, maybe we, even with some kind of hesitancy, I'm obliged to let them in because they have earned the right to be in my kingdom. And we'll call that the most extreme views of legalism. I think within the theological spectrum, it's so easy to defeat those extremes that most people retreat a little way so that they can have some safety in having to defend something which is unethical and untenable, but they retreat only enough that their biases can still be shown. And so we would have in America, and I'm going to take as an example, in the majority of charismatic Pentecostal churches, a nice little blend of Calvinism and Arminianism, and most of them really don't understand the theological foundations on which they're sitting, but they've kind of got this idea that God is awesome and God is majestic and God is great, and when the preacher makes a call, I come to the front and I say, yes, Lord, I want to be saved, and that one tiny little contribution is enough that I'm saved. I make my token acceptance. There's a little bit of my belief that is mixed with the magnificence of God, and I'm saved. Not only saved then, but saved forever. And so the contribution in many churches in America, and I would say Australia, and perhaps even sometimes within our own thinking, is that God does just about everything, but he does ask me to believe. That saves us for a lot of ethical questions about the justice of God and why he would choose some and not choose others. And we kind of feel safe that we've retreated enough away from hard Calvinism to feel comfortable with that. At the other end of the spectrum, we have some that would say, well, actually, we're not going to say that we earn the right to salvation, but we do the best that we can. We work as hard as we can. We be as obedient as we can. And if we trust in the merits of Jesus, then he will step in, and whatever deficiency there is in the merit that we have earned, then God will make up the deficiency. Are you comfortable with those two points of tension? And I think that if you were to really analyze it and press people for their theological positions, you would find that they would be somewhere along that spectrum, but most would gravitate one way to the other or the other. And within Adventism today, I could give you theologians who are at both ends of the spectrum. Would you agree, David? There are some that are very much reformed and evangelical in their understanding, and there are some of us who still like the idea that we've got an advantage on somebody because we only eat nut meat and we've never been in the water above our knees on a Sabbath ever, as if that somehow gave us credit. But I would like to say that if you really understand the soteriology, the salvation that was taught, certainly by one of our foremost pioneers, Ellen White, you would have to reject both of those positions as untenable. They do not reflect an understanding of Adventism. Adventism is a holistic view in which Ellen White speaks often of humanity and divinity combined, as if God is entirely responsible for our salvation, but he longs for us to trust in him. The Bible speaks of it very plainly. It speaks of the mystery of the gospel as Christ in you. John Calvin, one of the foremost reformers, spent his life teaching one single motif. We are saved in Christ. In Christ is our wisdom. In Christ is our redemption. In Christ is our sanctification. In Christ is our justification. We have faith because of Christ working in us. When we pray, it is because the Spirit is interceding for us. Our repentance is because the goodness of God leads us to repentance. Independence has been, from the Garden of Eden to the close of human probation, the enemy of righteousness. The idea that somehow we can operate as independent entities and that the righteousness that we earn or seek or develop in our own strength will somehow add to the potluck of God's festivities. But when those great reformed songwriters wrote those words, "Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling," they were giving the truth that is powerful, the truth that can rescue sinners, the truth that can set somebody free. We must forever dispense with the idea that as a church we need to demonstrate to the world meritorious righteousness. If we are zealous for Christ, if we are active for Christ, if we are passionate for Christ, it is because we have a deep understanding that happiness and holiness are bound by the same parameters. We are not holy because we have to be. We are holy because Christ wants us to be. Hebrews begins with a beautiful presentation of the magnificence of Christ and one of the keynote arguments for Jesus as being the better priest and the better redeemer and the better savior is that he loved righteousness and hated iniquity. And I long to belong to a church. I long to live in my life. I long for God to reorient my mind so that the holiness that he loves is the holiness that I love.
Yes, sir.
I want to be obedient, not because I seek to take away anything from the cross of Christ, but because I want so much to enjoy that abundant life that Christ has offered. I want my marriage to be the marriage of heaven. I want my career to be the career of heaven. I want my witness to be the witness of heaven, not because I feel insecure, but because I so much want that other people will come to find Jesus as attractive as I do. David, I think you are going to chip in and go through a couple of these last quotes.
Yeah, that'll be great.
I'll let you take over with this next one.
You keep the clicker. Thank you so much, Glenn. One of the things I love about what Glenn has done here is that he has not been... I don't know what happened there. One of the things I love about what you've done here, Glenn, is you have not been prescriptive, except maybe just in the autobiographical sense that you say you have come to the place where you have found holiness and happiness to be the same thing. I love that. But what I really like is that Glenn has not been prescriptive in this is what it is, because that would deny the subjective reality that every one of us are at different places. I've been a Seventh-day Adventist now for almost 20 years, and the place that I, or actually 20 years, the place that I am now is not the place that I was after I'd been an Adventist for 5 years or 10 years. And I don't make a distinction between Adventism and Christianity because I was never either or. I've always been a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. But the understanding and the place and the journey that I'm at now is not the same one that I was at 10 years in, 15 years in, etc. And I think we run into trouble when we tell people what is absolutely certainly the case, especially in this dichotomous relationship.
Yes.
And this is what you have to believe. And when we become normative, when we make our experience and our understanding normative for others, it's a violation of the statement that we read a couple days ago where Ellen White says, look, some people see the plan of salvation this way, and there's certain elements of the plan of salvation that make an impress on their mind. And others, because of their unique background and situation and genetic makeup and rearing, they view the plan of salvation from a different perspective. Of course, there's a multidimensionality to the language that's used for salvation. There's the legal element. There's the adoption element. There's the rescue element. There's the ransom element. I mean, salvation is so multifaceted that some people will be more impressed with one element of it. They'll say, oh, this is the point. And yes, that is the point. And where you're at right now in that place, praise God, rejoice in that. But we do ourselves and our community a disservice when we make our understanding normative for everybody else. As long as we are within the parameters of trusting totally to the righteousness of Christ, the different emphases, the different perspectives, and the different biographies, autobiographies, we need to allow that. Can you say amen to that?
Absolutely.
I'm not talking about different plans of salvation, but we have to allow people to experience Jesus in a way that is uniquely and wonderfully their own. Shortly after my coming to Christ, I came across this statement. Probably 5 years in, this statement made an impression that I'm going to share with you now on my mind. And it has continued to be probably my second or third favorite statement in all the voluminous writings of Ellen White. And I just want to take a moment here to walk you through it, because it really highlights the sola Christus concept that Glenn is seeking to articulate. And it brings together a profoundly Trinitarian theology. And I want you to see that. And the reason I highlight the point about a profoundly Trinitarian theology is perhaps more than any other place I've personally been, there is a movement within the Australian Seventh-day Adventist Church to question the Trinity. And there are movers and shakers, some of them go to my church, in fact, which I don't see in other places where I travel. And my primary complaint and my primary concern about people who subscribe to a non-Trinitarian view of the Godhead is not that I worry about their salvation or I think they're going to be lost because they don't understand the infinite nature of God exactly as I do, but I think that it seriously undermines the good news of the gospel. And I can't even understand the gospel, frankly, in a non-Trinitarian concept. I don't know what the good news is, and I'm not going to get into that right here. But what I want you to see is how profoundly good this news is and how profoundly Trinitarian it is and where Jesus is right at the very center of this whole beautiful thing that's happening. I want you to pay attention to the role of the Spirit. I want you to pay attention to the role of Jesus. And I want you to pay attention to the role of the Father as we read this quotation. And maybe it will have as profound an impact on you as it has had on me. So the first paragraph goes like this. Christ, our mediator, and the Holy Spirit are constantly interceding in man's behalf. Can we just begin with a hearty amen to that?
Yeah, amen.
Hallelujah. Where would we be without that constant intercession? But the Spirit pleads not for us as does Christ, who presents his blood shed from the foundation of the world. Let's just pause there. Does the Holy Spirit make intercession? Yes or no? Yes. Okay. Does the Holy Spirit present his blood? No. Okay. Why not? Because he didn't die. The Holy Spirit did not die on Calvary's cross. Neither did God the Father die on Calvary's cross. Are we together on that? Yeah. So the Holy Spirit intercedes, and Jesus intercedes, but then she makes this fascinating point. But the intercession of the Spirit is different. It's what? It's different from the intercession of Jesus. How so? Now she will elaborate. It says, the Spirit does not plead for us as does Christ, who presents his blood, shed from the foundation of the world. What does the Spirit do, Sister White? Oh, the Spirit, you want to know the intercessory work of the Spirit? The Spirit works upon our hearts, drawing out prayers and penitence, praise and thanksgiving. That is the whole of the Christian experience. Every part of the Christian experience is wrapped up in one of those four words, prayers, penitence, praise, and thanksgiving. Everything is wrapped up there. So the Spirit is drawing out the Christian experience, what you talked about, Glenn, holiness and happiness. The Spirit is drawing that out of us. The gratitude which flows from our lips is the, what's the next word?
Result.
Is the result of the Spirit's striking the chords of the soul in holy memories. I love this poetic language, awakening the music of the heart. Can you say amen? Yeah. So that's the first part. Jesus is doing a work which she has not yet fully elaborated on. That's the next paragraph. She does say that Jesus presents his blood, but she spends most of the time saying, this is what the Spirit does. The Spirit does this. Well, what does the Spirit do? The Spirit draws out prayers, praise, penitent confession of sin, obedience, worship, contrition. The Spirit is drawing out the whole corpus of the Christian experience, awakening the music of the heart. I love this because it presents the idea not of a legal, yeah, only a legal, but of God as a symphony director. Amen? Drawing, and your story is a little different from my story, and your biography is a little different than mine, and it coalesces to this grand and glorious climax that we see in Revelation, where everyone from their own unique and idiosyncratic perspective gives praise to God, and it's this beautiful, harmonious experience where our experiences are not identical, but they're harmonious. Amen?
Yes.
I love God as symphony director. Second paragraph. There are three. Now the transition to the intercessory role of Jesus. The religious services, like this one, and every religious service you've ever attended, the prayers, the praise, and the penitent confession of sin ascend from, and I've highlighted, what are those next two words there? True believers, not from hypocrites. True believers pray, true believers praise, true believers confess sin, true believers attend religious services. Okay, then what happens? Well, that those things ascend as incense to the heavenly sanctuary. So there it is. Your song, your prayer, your obedience, your attendance at worship service is ascending as incense to the heavenly sanctuary. So far, so good? There it goes. It ascends from you. And as it makes its way, you know, we're using language here, the language of metaphor, but the sanctuary was given to us as the metaphor to tell us what's happening in the salvation transaction. Passing, notice this, as incense to the heavenly sanctuary, but, and this is a big but, passing through the corrupt channels of humanity, that's you and I, they, what's they? The religious services, the prayers, the praise, the penitent confession of sin. They are so defiled. They are so what?
Defiled.
Just a question. Are they defiled because these people are hypocrites?
No.
What kind? Well, who are these people? They're true believers. So are the prayers, the praise, the penitent confession of true believers defiled according to this?
Yes.
And not they're not just defiled, they are so defiled. Notice this. How defiled are they, Ellen White? They are so defiled that unless they are purified by blood, I'll give you one guess as to whose blood that is. It's not the Holy Spirit's blood, it's Jesus' blood. They can never be of value with God. Now just let that settle in. When you sing, oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder, and you're singing, with all of your own self-understanding, you may be singing with all of the enthusiasm and all of the devotion and all of the surrender that you can, but there's a problem. Your heart, like my heart, is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked, and whether we know it or whether we intend it, there is carnality mingled with what it means to be us. Yes. Now, God doesn't discount us for that. He doesn't say, oh, you know, you're not perfect. But he does something amazing. He receives that. Actually, Jesus receives that. Notice what he does. They ascend not in spotless purity, and unless the intercessor, capital I, who would that be? That's Jesus. Now watch this. Who is at God's right hand? Oh, no. Who is at God's right hand? Who's the God there? That's the Father. Okay? So in the beginning, we had the intercessory work of the Spirit who draws. Did you see that? And now do we have the intercessory work of Jesus? Yeah, who's gathering, getting ready. And then now the Father is introduced. It's profoundly Trinitarian. It's undeniably Trinitarian is what it is. You might not like the word Trinitarian. You might like the word triune, whatever. Whatever your language is, there are three things going on here. There's the work of the Spirit going on. There's the work of Jesus going on. And there's the work of the Father going on. There is no way to truncate this statement and turn it into two. It just cannot be done. That's beside the point. Watch this. They, our works, ascend not in spotless purity, and unless the intercessor who is at God's right hand, that's juxtaposition, that's adjacency, they are not one and the same, here's God, here's Jesus, right, at my right, presents and purifies all by his righteousness. Whose righteousness? His righteousness. It is not acceptable to God. Now just get the picture here. Your praise, your prayers, your penitent confession of sin, your obedience, your holiness, your happiness. We're not talking about begrudging works. We're talking about the beautiful life of the Christian. Can you say amen? Amen. They ascend, but just as they're about ready to come into the presence of the Father, Jesus ropes them in and mingles with your best efforts, defiled, sadly. Yeah. Well, that's just the way it is. He mingles with his own spotless righteousness. Now watch, next slide. All incense from earthly tabernacles, that's you and I, must be moist with the cleansing drops of the blood of Christ. Now watch this. He holds before the Father. There it is again. There's juxtaposition, adjacency. Jesus and the Father. He holds before the Father. Now watch what he holds before the Father. The censer, that is the incense censer of, what are those next three words?
His own merits.
His own merits. So did your beautiful rendition of How Great Thou Art impress God and get you a little bit of treasury in heaven's merit?
No.
No, but don't mistake. It does bring pleasure to God's heart. God is not begrudgingly receiving what you're offering. The problem is that it is fundamentally flawed. It requires something else, and the something else that it requires is the merits of Jesus. To me, this is the perfect commingling of doing our best and still knowing that it falls infinitely short of God's amazing, perfect standard. So we do our best and we hand, as it were, the baton to Jesus. And Jesus is like, praise the Lord, I receive these. These are from true believers. Hallelujah. Mingles in his own righteousness. Now watch what happens. The censer of his own merits in which there is no taint of earthly corruption. Can you say amen?
Yeah.
He gathers into this censer, what? The prayers, the praise, the confessions of his people. And with these, he puts his own, what does he mingle in there? His own, what's the next word?
Spotless
righteousness. Woo! Then and only then, and this is the word here, I love this word, perfumed. Perfumed with the merits of Christ. That's a big fancy word, propitiation. It means sacrifice. Perfumed with the merits of Christ's sacrifice, the incense comes up before God, holy and entirely, what's the word? Acceptable. Then, and only then, gracious answers are returned. Final paragraph, and it's an easy one. Before we read the final paragraph, do you see how profoundly triune this statement is?
Yeah.
Let's remind ourselves, what was the work of the Spirit in this depiction? What does the Spirit do? Draws out of our hearts the symphonic, beautiful music of prayers, praise, and penitent confession of sin. That's the work of the Spirit. Was it the work of the Spirit to present his blood? Why not? Spirit didn't die. What's the work of Jesus? Well, the work of Jesus receives two full paragraphs here, not because the work of the Spirit, work of Jesus is more important than the work of the Spirit of the Father, but because from our perspective, where we're looking up, right, in the grand cinema that is the great controversy, Jesus is the keyhole through which we view the plan of salvation. I want to say that again. Jesus is the keyhole through which we view the plan of salvation. In fact, there are precious few times when you actually see God the Father in Scripture. You can count them on basically two fingers where we definitively see exclusively God the Father, and it's basically in the vision of Daniel. Daniel chapter 7, where the Ancient of Days is seated, and then in Revelation chapter 4, where the Ancient of Days is seated on the throne. All the other times we see God, we're seeing some combination of Jesus and the Father or Jesus. So because of where we're at, going back to the Copernican heliocentric view of the universe, yes, it does look like the sun is setting and the sun is rising. That's the way it appears to us, right? But we know now that the sun is not moving, we are moving. So from our earthly perspective, we look up and we see the grand plan of salvation through the keyhole of Jesus. Jesus plays a tremendous, unfathomably large role in human salvation. Can you say amen to that? Huge. Now, if we were an angel, we would see from a slightly different perspective. That wouldn't be a diminishment of Jesus' importance or primacy, but they would see the Father's role and the Spirit's role slightly different than we see it. But here, clearly Jesus is at the center of the whole thing. In fact, we know precious little about the Spirit, which has caused some in the non-Trinitarian movement to doubt his existence or his ontology as a being. This is a giant mistake. It's a huge mistake. Just because we don't know a lot about something doesn't mean that it's not there and that it's not a viable ontological person. Clearly, the Spirit is given the attributes of personhood here. The Spirit intercedes. Gravity does not intercede. Electromagnetism doesn't intercede. Nuclear force does not intercede. People intercede. Persons intercede. Agents intercede. Are you with me on that? So here's the Spirit interceding, here's Jesus interceding, complementary but different intercessory ministries. Now notice this, final paragraph. Oh! And I love the use of that oh there. Ellen White, there, that's a term of emotional investment. Oh! Oh! That all may see that, what's that next word?
Everything.
Everything in, what's the next word? In everything in obedience, in penitence, in praise and thanksgiving must be placed on the glowing fire of the righteousness of Christ. This is all sanctuary language. And notice this. The fragrance of this righteousness, whose righteousness? Christ's righteousness ascends like a cloud around the mercy seat. Can you say amen?
Yeah.
Sola Christus. You will never get to the place where you will take off the robe of Christ's righteousness and say, thank you so much, Jesus, for getting me to this point. I now give you back your robe of righteousness because I can take it from here. Right? Yeah. I now thank you for that. I've got it now. You won't do that at the end of time. You won't do that at the close of probation. You won't do it 10,000 years from now. 10,000 years from now, when you and I are standing on the sea of glass and we are clothed in white and Jesus is clothed in red, you will be standing in the righteousness of Christ.
Yeah.
And any good kindness and deeds and all of the wonderful holiness and happiness that will characterize our lives in the new heaven and the new earth will still be in response to Jesus' saving power. It will still be in response to what Christ has accomplished for us and in us. Amen? And so Sola Christus, right at the centerpiece, right at the guts of the Protestant Reformation, was this idea that everything that we ever could do, right, even from the best of intentions and the best of works and the truest of believers and the sincerest of hearts, cannot possibly, in fact, are we going to read the treason quote tomorrow?
Yes.
We'll read the treason quote tomorrow. Could not possibly merit any standing, any leverage with God. It all has to be wrapped up into the center of Christ's righteousness. And when that is presented before the Father, gracious answers are returned. Glenn?
Martin Luther on his deathbed said a few things, commented on some abstract poetry. But his dying words are believed to be this, and I think it's such a perfect summation of what David and I have been trying to communicate this morning. That when all and said is done, when we reach the end of our life's journey, when we look at the contribution that we have made to the argument between Christ and Satan, that we ultimately will confess, we are beggars. This is true. There is nothing that we have in and of ourselves. We would agree with Luther, we would agree with Augustine to the extent that the corrupt nature of man is incapable of producing and maintaining righteousness. But we would not agree with Luther or Augustine that we are so corrupt that we are incapable of being changed by Christ.
Or of desiring righteousness.
Through Christ, through faith, through grace, there is not a person in this tent this morning that is not incapable of experiencing plenteous redemption.
Thank you.
God is not out to kick us out. He's out to bring us in. Tomorrow we will make an appeal, but just in the closing 30 seconds, in your hearts today, if you want to say to Jesus, Jesus, forgive me for trusting in my own merits. Give me the confidence and the grace to rely wholly on you. I promise you, from personal experience and the experience of a multitude of witnesses, that hanging on to Christ, you will be holy, you will be happy, you will be healthy, you will experience the abundant life that he has on offer, that Amen. You will never taste while ever you are relying on yourself.
Mm.
And so in your heart, if you would like to say today with us, Jesus, all of you and none of me, I'd invite you to stand while David prays.
Mm. I'll stand to that. Father in heaven, even this prayer, as it ascends from a sincere heart, and it is representative of others that are praying from a sincere heart. But we are asking, Father, that as the Spirit draws this prayer out of us, as the Spirit does his intercessory work, his paracletos work, we pray that it would ascend and that Jesus would catch it up, and that he would mingle even this prayer in our lives and our whole autobiography, that everything that we are and everything that we have been and everything that we could be would be mingled with the righteousness of Christ, that he would take us into that censer and that it would be presented before you. Father, we believe that we can be your sons and daughters. We say with John the Apostle, behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons and daughters of God. Father, you do not save reluctantly. You do not save begrudgingly. You save joyously and happily. And we come to you as your adopted and born again sons and daughters. Help us to find in our own journey and in our own situation that story, that moment, that Emmaus Road experience where we come to rely totally on the righteousness of Christ. Father, perhaps for some it's going to be the equivalent of ascending Pilate's staircase on their knees and the words flash before them as it did for Luther, the just shall live by faith. Father, maybe here at 2017 Big Camp, this could be our moment where we come to the place and say, you know what? It's not a little bit of me and a lot of Jesus. It's what Jesus is doing.
Amen.
And so, Father, may we lean into the gospel. May we lean into your Son. And may we lean into you and to the work of the Spirit. Today, we have responded to the working and the wooing of your Spirit. And we pray that it would be received. We know that it is received because we pray in the mighty, saving, succoring, assisting name of Jesus Christ, let everyone say, Amen. Amen.